Hello everyone, this is Hiral here from Classcipe Operations. Welcome to the Classcipe PD Collective event. Classcipe is a New Zealand-based company aiming to create global community for educators, learners to share their knowledge and experiences with each other. With us, you can create your unit plan and task more easily and customize your template with accurate content recommendation. Our platform function includes interactive slides, customized templates, online, offline, and hybrid learning functions, managing classroom, co-teach, instant feedback, various modes of submission, and vibrant library content. You can create your own PD content, conduct fee-paid sessions, and become a workshop facilitator. You can use free resources present in our library and contribute to it as well. Do follow us on our social media to receive more information and updates. Moving on to the issuance of certificates. For today's session, we will only be having the certificate of attendance. This will be issued to those who are attending the live session uninterrupted till the end. We do not have the after activity, so there will be only one form. The feedback form will be sent to chat box. You need to fill up and submit it in order to get the certificate. We take 14 working days to issue certificates. Now let me introduce to our esteemed workshop facilitator, Dr. Kamini Rege. Dr. Kamini Rege is holding the position of Associate Professor in the Department of Human Development and has been teaching at the graduate and postgraduate position from over last 25 years, and also is recognized as PD PhD guide at the University of Mumbai for Home Science. She expertises in the specialization of human development and early childhood care and education. She has contributed wealth of her valuable knowledge and proficiency to various institutions and organizations as academician, consultant, and researcher. She is also the founder member and joint secretary of National Committee of Early Childhood Association, ECA, an Association of Primary Education and Research, that is APER, from India. She's a consultant to several institutes and organizations associated with teacher training and education and is deeply involved in the development of policy programs and planning activities for young children. Welcome, Dr. Kamini Rege.
Thank you so much, Sheila. Thank you so much. Thank you, Classcipe, for inviting me for this session. We begin the session now. Hello, everyone. I'm sure you're from various parts of the world, and it's my proud privilege to be a part of this session. That's the title of today's presentation, Designing Developmentally Appropriate Practices. Also, I have just framed out, a framework has been given, wherein I'll be covering the specific topics for this session, which includes what is early childhood education, basic objectives of early childhood education, roles and responsibilities of a teacher, and developmentally appropriate practices. So here we have the first question to all of you. What is early childhood education? So according to you, in your purview, in your understanding, what do you understand by the term or meaning of early childhood education? Because I'm sure every country, every different place has a different understanding about early years. So do I get the answers here only on chat, Ms. Hiral?
Ma'am. So here you will get also in the answers in the chat box. So maybe you can, you know, just try and check whether people are able to put it on our website or on our platform or in the chat box.
Okay. Fine. Thank you so much.
You can use the comment.
Okay. Most of them are using the link. So I will go to the link only to just have a look at what the responses are. So basically, yes, we are talking about children, especially between the ages of 3 to 8. We in India now are considering, with the new NEP, we are considering 3 to 8 years for primary, pre-primary school education. Definitely it has to be play-based. So yes, Mr. Ramkumar, you are absolutely right. And now we are going to the next slide, which is going to give you a complete glimpse of what basically early childhood education understands. So what is early childhood? We also want to label it as early childhood care and education. And the reason for the same is that there is a lot of care which is involved in early years, and that needs to be done by the so-called stakeholders, whosoever it could be. It could be parents, it could be teachers, it could be coordinators, anybody and everybody. So therefore, there are very, very important primary components of early childhood education, wherein we need to have a very good family community tie. There has to be readiness for the school. Definitely it has to have a readiness to school. So that's very, very important. Again, in addition to that, problem solving and independence is another very important feature. So I was talking about, maybe I'll repeat the two points that I missed out. Maybe you missed out while in the process. One is that definitely children need to have a lot of problem solving, independent learning, which has to be there. There's a high level of creativity in children, especially in the early years. Play-based learning, or what Mr. Ramkumar said, which is learning through play, we also call it. And for all of this, we require qualified teachers. We also require exploration and discovery in our preschool years. Numeracy and literacy is important because we are also considering it as foundation years. And therefore, the children are going to move into the primary level where writing, reading, learning, comprehension, all this is going to be an important part. So apart from all this, there is also collaboration and social interaction, which is very important. All of this together is what early childhood education is. But we have to also remember that every child learns in a different manner. Hiral, can we go to the next slide, please? Yeah. Thank you so much, Hiral. So here we will talk about, and we need to know that every child is different and every child has a different way of learning. And when I'm saying different style or way of learning, each one of us will understand that some of us as children, we would rather want to sit with our friends and do our studies. Some of us were very comfortable doing it by ourselves. Some of us were very comfortable doing it, writing, reading, or probably, you know, reciting in front of somebody and doing it. Sometimes we always wanted some music or somebody in the room. Probably some of us would lie on the grass in the garden and then study, and we would learn things easily. Some of us would make pictures out of it, maybe mnemonics out of it, some pictorial versions out of it, and then learn things. Sometimes we would make songs and stories out of it, and then we would learn. So each child has a varied way of, or probably multiple different ways of intelligence. And therefore, all of that needs to be catered to in the early years itself. In addition to that, we need to understand that what is early childhood education and what is not early childhood education. So Hiral, we will move now next to the next slide. So what is early childhood education? One of the point is early childhood education is a child-centered program which follows a playway, learning by doing, an activity approach. Very importantly, we keep pulling the child out and saying, okay, I will do it for you and give it. No, that's not how it needs to be done. Very, very important educator in the field of early childhood education, Maria Montessori. She emphasizes on and on, let the child learn and do things. Let it be his or her experiment to do it. It is going to be much more well engraved about how and whys of those, rather than when we tell them do it this way or do it that way. Yes, it means also a focus on the holistic development of the child, which provides stimulating play environment, which includes intellectual, it includes language, which includes social, emotional, and physical development. So whenever we are giving them an environment, the early childhood environment, it has to cover up at least two or three domains when we are giving them that environment. A simple example, if I have to give you. Can anybody tell me what is it that a swing or a slide teach us? Anyone? Anybody can share what your views are? What is it that the slide that we play on, the children play on? What is it that the slide teach us? Okay, interesting. I'm getting very wonderful examples here. It teaches us to have differential learning. It also teaches us to be forced, or force is what? Balance and coordination. Excellent. Fine. So some of you are saying force, some of you are saying balance, coordination, etc. Anything that goes up will come down because of the gravitational force. Excellent. Collaboration. Superb. I'm getting excellent examples and excellent responses. That's fantastic. I wish to share one more thing, which is slightly missing here. It teaches, which is actually missing in today's children, is it teaches us a lot of patience and organization. By itself, think about it. A child has to wait for his turn to climb up the staircase. He has to wait for his turn to climb that staircase, the stair which goes up. And then the enjoyment, the joy of looking at the surrounding from top, but also to know that I have to come down. So yes, life has ups and downs. and therefore he comes down. And then again, he doesn't stop there. He doesn't go away. He comes back to climb. That means the hard work pays. It's a beautiful example to say when we are talking about learning through play. It does teach us intellectual aspect, like I have to wait for my turn. I have to respect other person climbing. I can't go from the other side and take a wrong way up to the slide, because I'm going to hinder, I'm going to hurt many more people in the process. And if somebody comes from top and I'm in the middle of the way, I will be hurting them. So it's actually giving a wonderful life-like approach to the children. And that's where we are also helping the child develop emotionally, socially, and physically. Definitely, I think this example will give you a complete understanding of the concept of holistic development. Just one slide teaches actually the holistic development. So in this manner, there are many, many such events which the children will be learning through. We go to the next slide, Hiral. Thank you so much. Yeah. So when we are looking at a program of early childhood, a program which is laying a foundation for the development of readiness, preparedness for pre-reading, pre-writing and pre-arithmetic. That means before the child starts officially reading the sentences, books, or probably even for that matter chapters, or he starts writing in the so-called, you know, cursive writings, or, you know, all kinds of books, all kinds of different kinds of fonts, etc. It is important that we give him many experiences, such as cutting with scissors, playing with puzzles, manipulative toys, etc. Even things like counting, patterning, sequencing, ordering, you know, these are the different things which are going to help him in pre-mathematical skills. So this is another reason, or what is early childhood education, what we're talking about. This is another important feature of a program of early childhood education. The next point here is the program that encourages interaction with the environment. This is the only program. Otherwise, most of the children are sitting in the classroom situations where they are basically between the four walls, or within the four walls, and in front of a board, or probably a white screen or a whiteboard and things like that. Very rarely is a child interacting with the environment, but here in preschool, early years, is where the child is actively participating in group activities, creative problem solving, meeting nature friends, etc. And you'll find they're more curious in this age. The program that stresses on providing first-hand experience, how to do it, how to go about. It's okay if we make mistakes, but we need to do it. So first-hand experience to the children, in which would ensure a development of skills related to the process of learning. This is what is important. Next slide. It stresses, again, on prior planning. A lot of work goes into the hands of the teachers, because until and unless you're giving a proper planning, you're scheduling things, which may be at times flexible. But if you're not doing it for the children are not going to learn many, many things from you. So therefore, a lot of planning, a lot of coordination, a lot of advocating, a lot of understanding, a lot of guidance is needed from the facilitator, who is the teacher here. Okay, a program which indirectly promotes self-control, inner discipline, where the child is doing things by himself, accomplishing it, completing it, getting reinforced, winding up things and putting things back in place. This is something called as self-control and discipline. Very often then when the child grows up, you know, the parents keep telling, you know, when he comes back from the school, he just puts the bag here, he puts his shoes over there, he puts his socks over there, he doesn't put his uniform in place. Now, this is because in the early years, probably that self-control, that inner discipline was never taught to the child. So it's important that we teach the children at the foundational years. So now my next question to all of you is, so what is the basic objective of early childhood care and education? So here I'm waiting for the responses. Yes, Hiral, I can see the white band with waiting for the responses now.
Yeah, so when the participants will write answers,
we'll yes, be able to thank see you it. So much. I was unable to see that earlier, but now I can see it.
Okay.
I hope my question is, what are the basic objectives of imparting real life skills? Thank you, Mr. Ramkumar. To prepare children for the next stage. That's right. Any more? Or can we go ahead? Okay, we go ahead. So these are some of the objectives that are spelled out The first objective is to develop a good physique, adequate muscular coordination and motor skills in children. How this can be met? By giving them large muscle activities and fine motor activities. What includes in large muscle activities? Something like jumping, climbing, sliding, swinging, pedaling. These are the activities which will actually use the large muscle of the body. Whereas fine motor activities are more to do with smaller muscles, fine muscles, which includes tearing, cutting, pasting, drawing, painting, threading, stringing beads. These are the different activities which will give good physique and muscular coordination with increasing the motor skills. So the first objective is to develop good physique and adequate muscular coordination and motor skills in children. The second objective is to get good health habits and build up basic skills necessary for personal adjustment, such as dressing by themselves, toileting by themselves, eating by themselves, even sometimes dress, when we are saying buttoning, you know, their clothes, that's also a part of dressing. So basic skills includes even the conversation, which they can do it initially in the form of puppetry, stories, demonstrations, role plays, etc. And that will enhance or help in developing good health habits and basic skills, which are necessary for personal adjustment. We move to the next slide. The third objective that we have is to stimulate the child's intellectual curiosity concerning immediate environment, which means awareness of the environment, in which we have intellectual curiosity can be enhanced through opportunities to explore, investigate, experiment. Now, these are very important part. Very often the child asks us a question, why? And because we don't know the answer, we generally respond to them, I don't know, don't keep asking me these questions. Go and ask your teacher. Okay? It's important because we as parents or teachers need to investigate things. Help children learn through experiment. Allow children to ask questions. Explain them age-appropriate responses. Help them to draw conclusion and analysis. These are the things which are going to help them in future, in later life. Because these, as I said, brain development is the highest during this period and their grasping power is immense. So to encourage children's creativity and independence by providing him or her sufficient opportunities for self-expression. Very often we tell the children, don't cry, don't scream, don't shout. If the child has to show anger, it is important that the child needs to show anger. Because only thing is what you need to do is you need to label and you, as a teacher or parent, you need to handle. This can be achieved through painting, music, drama, puppetry, helping children to create their own objects that are that is something which is of the child's choice. Help the child realize or relieve his pent-up emotions, stress, strain. How this can be done? You know, there are lots of toys nowadays in the market which are available. Something like hammering a toy or probably a bobo doll, you know, which is like, you know, hit me dolls kind of a thing. These can help the child remove his pent-up emotions or stress. And therefore, he will not show it on another child or he will not show it on his own sibling. Yes, thank you. Next one, Hira. Thank you, Hiral. To develop in children the ability to express his thoughts and feelings in fluent, correct and clear speech, which means language development. So we have looked at physical development, we have looked at emotional development, we have looked at social development, we have looked at cognitive or also language as a part of cognitive development. This can be developed with the help of stories, books, poems, free conversation. We also call it as circle time, constructive play, adding new words, opposites, vocabulary. And these vocabularies need not be necessarily only English based. Sometimes the vocabulary can be maths based also. Something like far, near, long, short. These are all mathematical vocabularies. So another point or objective of early childhood education is to develop desirable social attitude and manners, to encourage healthy group participation by making the child sensitive to the right and privilege of being members of social group, to encourage children to cooperate and take turns or greet. This is what it is about the objectives of early childhood education. These are the last two objectives, and they are, though short, but makes lot of sense. One of them is talking about emotional maturity, to develop emotional maturity by guiding the child to express, understand, accept, control child's feeling and emotions. Within this, I'm sure all of you know that there's something called as IQ, EQ, SQ. Now, which means it talks about intellectual quotient, emotional quotient, spiritual or social quotient. And there is a new quotient which everybody needs to consider and think about and work on, is called as RQ. Can anybody tell me what is RQ according to you? What quotient is it? You can put it in the chat box if you need. What is RQ? What quotient is it?
So, Sri Lakshmi, Miss Sri Lakshmi says,
she is mentioning reasoning, reasoning as one of the point.
Yes.
One of the point, reasoning. But it's not reasoning. Anybody else? Yeah?
Miss Rosina is saying response.
Okay, response is also not the right answer. Come on, one more try. Let's see, one more try. I'll give you a hint if you're not able to answer. It's a reliability. No, it's not reliability. It's something to do with bouncing back. Bouncing back. I've given you a synonym to it. Bouncing back. No, not excellent. Piyush Rai has given the answer. Resilience quotient. And today that's most needed. Resilience quotient. Because otherwise the children are taking all wrong steps in their teenage years. That they do not know. The minute they fail, they are not wanting to work out and do the work all over again. They feel that's the end of life. So that's another important part that one needs to think about. Thank you so much for your response. Yes, it's a resilience quotient. So when we are talking about emotional development with children, it's important to talk about IQ, EQ, SQ and RQ also. So now as educators, you all need to go back and look for what is RQ and how can you enhance RQ in children. That's going to solve a lot of problems for many, many children today. To encourage aesthetic appreciation. Thank you so much for your thumbs up. Okay. To encourage aesthetic appreciation in children. Aesthetic appreciation. Why it is needed? All of us are interested in, whenever we even dress up, we want somebody to compliment us. Okay. And that compliment, when it doesn't come, we get very, very uneasy about it. Why so-and-so did not notice? No, I was ready. I had put this, I had put that, but nobody noticed. Now, this aesthetic appreciation suddenly doesn't come in the age of adulthood. It has to come from the childhood. And are we interested in enhancing that in our children? Are we appreciating their beauty? It could be as a pretty flower on the dress. Wearing such a wonderful shoe. I love that shoe that you're wearing. The socks has such a nice picture on it. Now, when we're doing that, we are doing nothing else, but we are giving an aesthetic appreciation to the child and appreciating beautiful things around the environment, such as pretty flowers, colorful butterflies, but beautiful art or craft work is one thing, but something which is going to help the child. Oh, your eyes are so beautiful. Your eyelashes are so beautiful. Your fingers are so beautiful. Even saying that can also enhance, and this will help the child learn. Okay, I also can appreciate something about somebody. Just don't do it as a matter of, fact that every day you have to do it. But you are genuinely wanting to do it. It's important that we need to do it. Thank you so much. We go to the next slide. So here is my very, very important slide, which is if we have to develop all these, what is early childhood education? And if you want to make this objective very, very clear as to these 8 objectives very clear, what is the role of a teacher? I want you all to write down what should be the role of a teacher. Okay, to inspire and facilitate learning among children. Very good. To have patience to listen and participate and understand the children. Very good. Okay, let me ask you one more question. How many of you are teachers by yourself? How many of you are teaching in the preschool? Or how many of you have children? Okay, yes, 2 of them. Thank you, Lakshmi. And you're also teaching, I assume. Both are true for you. That's nice, Mr. Ram Kumar. Sri Lakshmi and a teacher too. Very good. Very good. Okay, so let me ask you this question then. Now that I'm getting some responses and they're very interesting responses. Is it does it happen like this, that when you're doing a good job, when you're doing a very good job in your school or in your organization, because you're doing a good job, the work keeps on getting added on and on and on and on and on, and you never get time to do anything which you have actually planned. So you are actually overloaded with work because you're doing a good job. Has it ever happened with you? Oh, yes. I get quick answers here. Yes, I do. All right. Anybody else who feels that yes? Okay. How many of you feel that the pre-primary teachers are overloaded with work? Definitely work adds, as they feel that we are more responsible. Absolutely. All teachers and in the preschool, pre-primary level are overloaded with work. Not only pre-primary. Okay. The secondary also and primary also. Fine. Stay back. Physical activities. Yes, definitely. Some of you, I don't know in different countries what happens, but in India, we have sometimes the teachers have to take two or three shifts of children also. That means the morning that the teacher comes, she goes back only at the substitute, free periods. Everything is chock-a-block. Absolutely. So then now it's important that we hold on. Let me see if I want to show the video now or a little later. Hiral, can we do that? If I have to show the video a little later, can we do that?
Yes, I can come back to this.
We can, no? Okay, we can. Yes. All right. No, I'm just trying to see what. Okay. So we just keep that video on hold a little bit right now. So now, when I'm asking you this question, some of you have given beautiful answers that, the teacher has to be responsible and teacher has to be good and understanding and participative and listening and, learning facilitator, etc. I think you've really underestimated the teachers. I'm going to now show you what a preschool teacher actually is, actually any teacher for that matter, whether it is a primary teacher, secondary teacher or pre-primary teacher. What is she? So basically, a teacher is everything that you see here. She is a comedian. She is a musician. She is a detective. She's an author because she writes some stories, some songs. She's a mediator. She's a mediator. She's a doctor. She's an actor. She's a photographer. She's an event coordinator. One event is over and the next event is on her head. One festival is over and the other festival. She has to maintain accounts. She has to be a counselor to the parents, counselor to the children, counselor to the helpers who are there. She has to be a good nutritionist. She's an artist. Don't you think these are multiple jobs that we are doing as a teacher? And we are only being paid for one person against the so-called so many jobs that we are doing. I'm sure I'm going to get some nice smileys now. Are you all searching for the smileys? I don't mind waiting. Okay. So we move to the next slide. Yes, thank you so much. So true. I was thinking maybe you're looking out for that smiley emoji right now. So yes, we have a lot of jobs to do, but our major jobs are to be a facilitator, which means we have to be a mentor, we have to be a learning facilitator, we have to be learner facilitator, we have to have students' contact on the job role, role model, teaching model, informator, provider, we have to give lectures here and there, we have to talk about it, we have to have clinical practices also, medical expertise also, a resource developer also, material creator, study guide producer, lesson plan creator, organization of the classroom. If any head comes or a coordinator comes on a round, then you should say, what, your class is so messy, why don't you put things in place, curriculum planner, curriculum evaluator, student assessor and whatnot. But if you're good at everything, more and more jobs keep coming. Now we see the video. Now what is important is all of you have to watch that, whether what is your role. This lady without the cap, just hold on, Hiran. So this lady without the hat is the supervisor. Okay. She's instructing the two individuals who are working in a factory that if you do a good job, you will get better incentive. So initially when they start working, it's a cakewalk for them. But as soon as she sees that they are doing a very good job, she increases the speed of the job and she keeps on adding stuff to the job and then see what happens. So here we are. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Now, the candy will pass by on this conveyor belt and continue into the next room where the girls will pack it. Now, your job is to take each piece of candy and wrap it in one of these papers and then put it back on the belt. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes ma'am.
Let her roll! Let her roll! Well, right here. Somebody's asleep at the switch.
What are you doing up here? I thought you were downstairs boxing chocolates.
Oh, they kicked me out of there fast.
Why?
I kept pinching them to see what kind they were. This is the fourth department I've been in.
Oh, I didn't do so well either.
No. All right, girls. Now, this is your last chance. If one piece of candy gets past you and into the packing room unwrapped, you're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Oh, this is easier.
Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
Teacher needs to have is teaching skills, planning skills, communication skills, problem solving skill, and quality is understanding, creative and resourceful, firm and fair, adaptable, enthusiastic and fun loving. This is very, very important for any teacher to have. And when there is a balance of both these, I'm sure she makes a wonderful teacher. So basically, we have covered responsibilities and qualities of a teacher, where we are talking about responding quickly to each child when the need is there, when the child needs it, adapt to different learning styles or different styles and abilities of a child, provide many opportunities to communicate, facilitate successful communication or completion of tasks, alert to the sign of stress. When you see a child is stressed, it's important that the teacher needs to be alert about it and also address it. No appropriate stress-reducing activities. Next slide. Okay. And therefore, Whenever it just feels that it's okay to do one training program and get a permanent job, but that's not how it needs to be. There has to be multiple staff development programs and trainings which have to be ongoing, wherein it includes the induction training. The induction is when the teacher is being taken into the job, when she's being inducted into a program. Then there is a job orientation. What is her role? What is her responsibility? The in-service education, when she's working in the field, it is important to have her in-service education. That means her upgradation every year, every probably 6 months, etc. Continuing education and training for special functions. All of this is important for a teacher to be a good teacher. So a staff development program is must. And if a teacher has not done any training over 2 years, more than 2 years, I don't think that teacher needs to be really retained in the school, because it also talks about how much is she wanting to grow and how much is she wanting to understand the change in the world around, which is going to get affected to the children or to herself. So yes, teachers are, there's a high level of burnout for all kinds of teacher because of the workload, because of the lack of sleep, because of the work-life balance, because of no feedback sometimes, a lot of coaching or probably no training which is there, no recognition to the teacher. And therefore, basically by the end of every day, basically her the battery runs down. And therefore, it's important that the teacher needs to be respected. She needs to be understood. And also, there has to be a balance for her also. So there has to be a balance of work and family life both. Okay, so when we're talking about all of this, it's important to understand the word teach doesn't imply or just implies, tends to imply telling or giving. But the correct way of teaching a young child is not by lecture or verbal instruction. It is only to guide and facilitate. All right, now we're moving to designing a developmentally appropriate practice. What do you as teachers or parents or educators understand by this term, designing developmentally appropriate practice? That's it? Okay. So now, because probably some of us are knowing this term or maybe understanding this term in our own way, we need to have understanding about what is not developmentally appropriate. So let's first understand what is not developmentally appropriate for us to know what is developmentally appropriate. So whenever a program, any kind of a preschool or a school-going program, which is basically a formal, appropriate practices achieves the goal. Yes, definitely it achieves the goals, but how do you achieve the goal? You need to know what is not DAP for you to know what is DAP. Now, whenever it is a teacher-centered program following a very formal classroom approach, when the focus is only on the school's achievement, how my school is doing, but those children who are not doing well, how do I help those? If that concept is not there, then it's a non-DAP preschool or school. So whenever it is teacher-centered, a formal classroom approach, a focus of school achievement, then definitely it's a non-DAP approach. Next slide. Whenever it is syllabus bound, I have to complete my syllabus. It's important to complete the syllabus, but syllabus should not become the focus of everything. Downward extension, what is required in primary, I have to teach in pre-primary. So that in primary, teachers should not scold me that I did not teach this. So that's a downward extension of primary education grade, which is a non-DAP program. We have to make sure what is required for the child in his age, for his development, what is required and how much can be taught, that is what is developmentally appropriate. Next slide. What is not DAP? Teachers making children read, write or do numbers. We did mention this in the earlier slide that early childhood education is a platform for pre-reading, pre-writing and pre-arithmetic. We did not say reading, writing and arithmetic. And whenever in the preschool we are doing this, which means it is a non-DAP school. Emphasize on passive listening and rote learning. Only teacher says, children only listen and children only rote learn. That is a non-DAP preschool. Next slide, please. Examination oriented. Ye sab kyu karna hai? Why do we want to do it? Because we have examination. We have to get good marks for examination. The minute it becomes an examination oriented setup, center, emphasis lies on the product rather than the process. That's what is non-DAP or non-ECC. Whenever it's a rigid, structured, inflexible timetable. Today I see that the children are not in a mood to sit and study maths. They want to go out. They want to see things outside. You may not necessarily all the time do that. But someday when you feel that the children are really restless, today the environment is beautiful outside, then it's okay to change or be a little more flexible and change your timetable. That's what very, very important. Next slide, please. What is non-DAP or not DAP? Demands unquestioning obedience and strict classroom discipline. Demands unquestioning obedience. Very often we have this concept of put your finger on your lips. But why? I can still talk with my finger on my lips. We do that even as adults. We will put our finger on a lip and then still continue talking it. So is it really making any sense in making them obedient like that? If a child wants to ask you, what is the mistake that I have made? If there's a question that comes from him or her, we need not get upset because he needs to know what was his mistake. And it's okay for his right to know as to why you are scolding him or her. Okay? The minute you say this into this is so and so, if the child asks why, and if you start scolding, that's how it is. You don't know your multiplications? No need. Then that school is a non-DAP school. We move to the next slide. So now it's important to understand that NAEYC, this is one of the wonderful and the beautifully framed organization in USA, National Association of Early Years Center, which has created certain developmentally appropriate practices for young children, and it has been adapted from the position statement that have been framed by multiple experts in the field of early childhood education. So they have given wonderful statements as to what and the components of developmentally appropriate practices. We are now going to look at it. Can we go to the next slide? DAP means, this is what the meaning of developmentally appropriate practices is. DAP means teaching children the right things at the right time and at the right age. It's so beautifully given. DAP means teaching children the right things at the right time and at the right age. Next slide, please. Okay. So when we say age appropriate, it means based on the knowledge of a typical development of a child. When we say culture or social appropriate, it is based on the learning experience which is going to be meaningful and relevant to the child who is respectful. Now we have in India something like we have a place called as Rajasthan. And there you get more, you are in a desert. Okay. So if you talk about, you definitely can talk about snow. But you if you say that, okay, let's go out and you will get an experience of snow, that's not going to happen in that place. So you have to make things more social and cultural appropriate. If you're going into a rural setup and you talk about fancy things like mall, probably that may not be understandable by a child because he's not into the social and cultural appropriateness. So another important point that developmentally appropriate practices, the dimension of it is individual approach or individual appropriateness. Based on the understanding of an individual child, growth, patterns, strengths, interests, and experiences. So therefore, a three-dimensional, which are linked together, which is called as developmentally appropriate concept, is age appropriate, social and cultural appropriate, and individual appropriate. Next slide, please. Children do not need to be forced to learn. They should be motivated by their own desires and make sense of their world. This is very, very important again. When we are forcing them, that means we are asking them to do rote learning. But when they understand it, it becomes easy for them and they feel the sense of responsibility of learning that. Next slide, please. Children spend most of their time playing and working with material and with other children. And mind you, when they're doing this, there's a lot of science, social studies, maths, which is automatically developing within themselves. They do not wander aimlessly. They are not expected to sit in one quiet place for a long period of time. They may be wandering, but it's not aimless. There is something which is going on in the child's mind, on his hands, in his legs, in his movement, etc., etc., etc. Next slide, please. Curriculum is adapted. Teachers recognize that the children's different backgrounds and experience mean that they do not learn same things at the same time in the same way. So therefore, multiple experiences will have to be given to by the teacher. For example, if the children are playing with sand, various examples or various experiments, various ways of sands will be given by the teacher for the child to experience the sand experience for the children as they are playing. So when we are talking about curriculum is adapted, teacher recognize that the child is different, coming from a different background, coming from a different experience. They do not learn the same things at the same time in the same way. Next slide, please. Children should have access to various activities such as building blocks and other construction material, props for pretend play, picture books, paints, table toys, matching games, pegboards, puzzles. Now, when we are saying all this, children should not all be doing the same thing at the same time. So when we are talking about these activities that we are talking about, like pretend play, picture books, paints, table toys, matching games, pegboards, puzzles, these should be separately placed in different centers, which are also called as learning centers. And let the child make the choice where he wishes to go, what he wants to play with, wind up that place and come to the next one. So that's what is going to be responsibility of a child, for choosing, for doing that activity, accomplishing that activity, feeling satisfied and moving from there. Classroom is supposed to be, now this is what we see in most of the so-called elite schools also, that the classroom walls and the corridor walls are beautifully painted by artists. But according to an Indian educator also, Giju Bhai Badeka, he also says, if your classroom is painted and organized by child's work, then that is the school which is giving importance to the child. So it's very important that the decoration is the child's original work, such as artwork, his own writing, invented spellings, stories dictated by the child to the teacher. Now, if that is how it is going to be, then that classroom is supposed to be the best classroom, or that school is supposed to be the best school, because that school is giving importance to the child's work. The child learns numbers and alphabets as well as vocabulary, but in the context of everyday experience. Now, when you are telling the child that, okay, go and have a pretend play of bus service today. You have become a bus driver or a conductor and go and play. What is the child doing? He's doing nothing else. He's counting the number of people who are coming to the bus. He's counting the money that the people are giving. He's giving the tickets to them. So it's all about, you know, one-to-one correspondence, counting, numeracy, waiting for a person, going a long way. So all these are mathematical skills that he's learning. The natural world of plants, animals are meaningful activities like cooking, taking attendance, serving snacks, providing basic learning activities. Simple things like during the meal time also, if the child is going and putting the plates for everybody, he's doing a one-to-one correspondence, which we don't realize that the child is doing it. Or even if you're saying, okay, let's display the plates and let's serve the food for everybody. He's counting people. Okay, so many people have got it. So many people are still left. It's addition and subtraction that he's doing. But we don't understand this concept and we say, okay, we have not done any studies today. It's not like that. The child is doing maths, reading, writing, arithmetic, at every minute if you're giving him the right experience. Children work on project and have a long period of time to play and explore. Worksheets should be used as minimum as possible. Children have an opportunity to play outside every day. Outdoor play should never be sacrificed for more instructional time. That means because you want to give instructions, because you want to do your worksheets, because you want to complete your syllabus, therefore their outdoor play is sacrificed. That should never happen. Children and their parents look forward to school. Parents feel secured about sending their child to the program, and children are happy to attend. They do not cry regularly or complain or feel sick. Now, this is where the parent involvement part comes into picture. The parents have to feel secure. The parents have to feel that I wish to send my child. The child should say, I don't want to miss my school, which means what? The child likes the school. The child doesn't want to stay back. He feels he's learning every minute in the school. Teachers read books to children individually or even small groups throughout the day, just not a group story for one day. So maybe sometimes the child wants to understand something more specific. So there should be always a way or a possibility of keeping some kind of a book corner for children where they can go and sit, they can relax, they can lie down, they can be the way they wish to in that story corner. And the teacher narrates a story, maybe sometimes the choice of a child, sometimes it will be the teacher's choice, and makes it more meaningful experience. Okay, the classroom situation or arrangement for large group activities can be something like this, which is also called as circle time, where the teacher can even discuss, you know, okay, 2 days you had holidays, what all did you do? So each one of them engaging, each one of them discussing, each one of them sharing what they did on those 2 days which were holidays. Some of them may say, you know, we went for an outing, we went for a holiday, I went to my grandparents' house, my grandparents came over home, and all those kind of things. It will all depend on what kind of discussions do you have, and this can be a large group activity. These could again be large group come small group activity. Some children are not interested in giving a big discussion over there. So therefore, you are also creating some kind of learning corners where children are sitting and enjoying their learning corners. Those who wish to be with the teacher can be with the teacher. This is also called as free play activity, which needs to be a part of the curriculum, and wherein after a while, you may find two or three children who may leave that learning corner and may want to join you, or some of the children who are sitting with you may want to go and play with the toys which are kept over there. So this is how we talk about free play activities. Next one, the arrangement of tables, if in case we are planning to have, should be such that the teacher is able to view each and every child, as well as is approachable to each and every child, which is either closer or farther away from the teacher. Now, there are some guidelines of program scheduling. Whenever we are thinking of any kind of a program which is for scheduling the whole day, week, or even year, month, etc., it is important to consider the group size. When I'm saying group size, I'm talking here about number of children in my class. Also, their arrival and departure time. What time are they coming into the school class and what time are they leaving? The next one could be even seasonal condition, that okay, is it going to be very cold, is it going to be very hot, is it going to be springtime, is it going to be monsoon time, what is the time of the year, and therefore what am I planning. Alternatively, active versus quiet play. Too much of quietness and too much of activeness is going to ruin the entire activity that you're doing. So there should be a balance, there should be an alternate balance. Also, there has to be a balance between the child initiated activity and a teacher initiated. When a teacher is going to tell the story, it becomes teacher initiated activity. When a teacher is doing an art and craft activity or instructing them for art and craft activity, it is more teacher directed activity. Activities that are developmentally appropriate and to the level of the child is something that needs to be considered. Next slide. I suppose we have come to the almost the end of the slides. So these are some of the interesting theory books which are important for early childhood educators to have. We call it as theory to practice, theories into practice. So these are important books which we need to consider or keep in mind. Can we go to the next slide? Another one which is on contemporary issues, early childhood theories and contemporary issues. How children learn. Okay, please fill the feedback form before you leave. In case if you wish to leave, please fill the feedback form. And how the children learn, and from the different educators, right? From Frobel to Pestalozzi to Rousseau, Jean-Jacques Rousseau. So these educators have given wonderful examples and experiences of how children learn. And early childhood education teachers should know about it. Okay. So tell me and I forget. Teach me and I remember. Involve me and I learn. This is what I will end my session today with.
So thank you everyone for joining us today. The feedback form is shared in the chat box. Fill it up in order to receive the certificate of attendance. As mentioned earlier, you need to, so we will only be giving one certificate today, the certificate of attendance. There is no certificate of participation. And this was our final session for our PD Collective series, and we would like to thank you all for participating and making it a huge success.
Thank you so much. Those who are sharing, thank you for me. I'm also thanking you for attending the session. I'm glad that it was wonderful and excited, insightful. Thank you so much.
Also, I would like to explain about our Educator Partner Project. We are looking for educator partners around the globe and would like you to all to join for the same. We will support you to become an educator influencer and connect to the global community. As our educator partner, you will also be able to open a personal channel, buy and sell content, get your resources promoted by Classcipe to its users. You can also become a workshop facilitator and conduct live free paid workshop sessions. You get free access to Classcipe premium functions, which are like some of our global resources, manage your classroom and students easily. With us, you can aspire to step higher in your career development, and can increase your influence and networks.